Good afternoon, everyone. First of all, I would like to thank Kolhapur Academy of Pediatrics for providing me this opportunity to moderate the session. As you all know, the common in our day-to-day practice, skin problems are very common, and they are very much confusing and sometimes difficult to treat. So, to guide us on this topic, we have our renowned dermatologist, Dr. Arun C. Inamdar, sir. He will guide us on clinical clues in pediatric dermatology. It is my honor to introduce him. He is a very senior dermatologist. Sir is MD, FRCP, professor and head of Department of Dermatology, PLD University, Vijaipura. He is a consulting dermatology since 30 years. He has 30 years of UG-PG teaching experience. He has around 180 publications to his credit and has edited 10 books and has contributed for 60 chapters. He is an executive editor for Indian Journal of Pediatric Dermatology Review. He is a chief editor in Clinical Dermatology Review. He is a member of Specialty Board of NBE Delhi. He is a member of Board of Studies, Faculty of Medicine, Rajiv Gandhi University of Health Sciences, Bangalore. It is an honor to have you, sir. I request you to kindly proceed with your talks.
Good evening. I would like to first share the slides. Hope the slides are visible. Is it okay?
Yes, sir.
Hello?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Okay.
It is.
Good evening to all of you. Thanks for making me a part of this Kolhapur Academy of Pediatricians. In fact, the Kolhapur Academy of Dermatologists are also very active. I have a lot of good friends in Kolhapur. Today, I will be talking on some clinical clues on a common pediatric dermatologist, dermatological conditions, actually. I will start with some hypopigmented lesions and with different conditions in the process. If the time is not there, whenever you feel that, okay, I must stop, you can always tell the chairpersons. This is how the children with different hypopigmented patches come to you. Of course, it looks almost similar. Some of them may look like vitiligo themselves. And invariably, the parents wants you to tell it is not vitiligo. That is the actually parental anxiety. Anyway, there are good number of diseases which we can deal with. So how to approach hypopigmentary disorders in children would be the first topic. These are believed to be the commonest group of dermatoses in pediatric age group. And they can be either genetic or the acquired ones. And invariably, it is the heightened parental concern which makes the children to be brought to the consultations. And they can be congenital or acquired, I already told you. The acquired ones are the vitiligo, pityriasis alba, pityriasis versicolor, polymorphic light eruption, and lichen striatus. And congenital ones, the white the lesions of the acellular macules in tuberous sclerosis, nevus depigmentosus, or pigmentary mosaicism, and sometimes the albinism also. But whatever said and done, the most common five are actually the pityriasis alba, vitiligo, nevus depigmentosus, tinea versicolor, or pityriasis versicolor. In India, you must add the leprosy also as in the skin. This is the most common presentation of a white patch over the face which comes to you, and very subtle hypopigmentation, very mild scale, and you cannot define them actually. And if you see carefully the pictures, in the right side of the picture, you can see even the Denny Morgan fold also. There is some indication that the child is having some atopy also. So it is nothing but the pityriasis alba. There will be personal history of atopy, itching will be very mild, fine adherent scale will be there. Clinical clue is the more prominent after washing the face with the soap. Invariably, they come, especially children, ladies, actually the female child, the parents say, whenever the child washes the face, it becomes more prominent, sir. So that becomes more drier, more scaly, and it has become more obvious also. The treatment would be very simple. Topical mild steroids like hydrocortisone, desonide, or clobetasol butyrate can be used. And for about 2 weeks or so, things would be all right. And ask them not to wash the face quite often. Almost similar looking presentation, but here there are multiple lesions. Not only that, the components you should look at. There in the first case, vitreous alba, only hypopigmentation was there. Here in this, both hypo and hyperpigmented lesions are also there. So this is the eruption, what we call as over the face, which is unexposed area, called as polymorphic light eruption. It is hypersensitive to the ultraviolet rays. And that's why you must use the sunscreen. Invariably, sunscreens used are the physical agents like zinc oxide or titanium dioxide containing sunscreen. And what is important is, depending upon the school timing and all, you have to plan the sunscreen application. If at least every 3 hours, the sunscreen has to be applied between 10 to 4, which is the heightened activity of the ultraviolet rays. Even topical steroid like mild hydrocortisone, desonide, or mometasone can be used. If really there is an itching, then antihistaminic. Invariably, with sunscreen and topical steroid, the result would be there. And then comes the real one, that is vitiligo, where there is almost complete depigmentation. Invariably, children will have the segmental-like thing, linear or segmental-like thing. And if you see the borders, it will be convex borders which are seen over the lesions. So it occurs in about 1% of the pediatric patient, increased incidence of segmental vitiligo, which I showed you. Then comes the focal, only acral areas like hands and foot, and then the lip will be involved. And this is the standard one. Otherwise, you can also see after segmental vitiligo vulgaris, any part of the body with extensive lesions can also be seen. What are the clinical pearls? How do you recognize them? Of course, complete depigmentation, convex borders, and premature graying in the immediate or extended family members. This is also one clue by which you can see. Compared to that, albinism, it is congenital, and clinical pearl here is normal eye color, hair color is retained in vitiligo compared to the albinism. So if you can find the changes in eye color and hair color, well, you are dealing with albinism. Then how do you treat this vitiligo? I will restrict to the part where you can go or as a pediatrician. Like, first choice should be always topical steroid, either fluticasone. And then comes the topical calcium inhibitor, simply because they overcome the topical side effects of the steroids. That's why we often use now tacrolimus. Is less than 16 years old, 0.93% ointment, and even the pimecrolimus can be used. Often these topical calcineurin inhibitors are useful when the lesions are over the neck, like the thin area of the skin, like especially face, eyelids, they respond very well. And alternative therapies, well, if it is more than 6 years, we have to use the narrowband UV therapy or topical PUA therapy. And less than 6 years, you don't have to use the ultraviolet therapy with the sorolens, because the anterior eye development is not there and patient may develop some eye complications. So as a pediatrician, well, you can go from topical steroid like fluticasone and then the topical calcineurin inhibitor. And after that, if the body surface area is more, definitely is a case for narrowband UV therapy. Wherever there is institution, you can always send the patient. Then this is just one example where the size of the vitiligo has come down after topical calcineurin inhibitors almost to the 60%. Of course, within 3 to 6 months, probably a complete repigmentation definitely occur. Sometimes it so happens, you may find a child coming with lesions or the genitalia. There are two conditions which I have presented here, but they look alike. They almost, at the first look, okay, so I'm dealing with vitiligo. It may not be so simply because they are different clinically. If you see more closely the other side compared to the one which is on the black circle there, what I am focusing here is not vitiligo. It is called as lichen sclerosis at atropicus. Clinical clue here is perianal area is also involved, almost like a figure of eight, which I made to the red borders. And if you see carefully, there will be atrophy and also some erosions. In the inset is the peak of vitiligo. So this is how you have to differentiate between vitiligo and lichen sclerosis at atropicus. Sometimes it so happens that we dermatologists write the same treatment. Of course, the topical calcium inhibit helps in both. But then what is the fun in differentiating them would be the question. Well, why you should follow up these cases and why you have to make a difference between vitiligo and LSA is lesions persisting beyond puberty needs to be examined every 6 months or annually for possibility of malignancy in case of lichen sclerosis at atropicus. Any newly arising nodules, erosions, ulcers, they require histopathological examination, though treatment is topical steroid and tacrolimus ointment. Well, sometime it so happens that you may see a child with hypopigmented patches present since birth. All these pictures depict the same thing. What you have to look at is the outline. They're all irregular, unlike the very convex border seen in vitiligo. And they are since birth. What is important is they will be stable in size and shape. But this, the parents should never agree with it. Simply, they were very small and now they are becoming big. That is just proportional growth of the body by which you see that it is becoming big. And how do you, anyway, that is how the things come as the nevus depigmentosus, we call them. And they are present at birth, stable in size and shape, irregular outline, size increase in proportion to the growth of the child. Decrease but not absence of the pigment will be there if you examine. And how do you explain? Biggest difficulty is invariably the parents will persist with the answer, no, sir, they are becoming big, give some treatment. So what I did, I did a small innovation that you take a small used pen and put a balloon, mark that the nevus or the balloon and just blow it. What happens is the balloon grows, but not the nevus, but nevus stretches according to the proportion. This make them convinced. In fact, interestingly, this published in an international journal called as Pediatric Dermatology. These simple things are useful to explain to them. This would be a great help to convince them that it is proportional growth. Then how do you treat? In fact, if at all you want to treat, there can be partial repigmentation with autologous melanocyte graft. Some centers do it, and the cosmetic cover-ups can also be done. If you tell them that it is not vitiligo, number one, they are happy. If you can convince them that it is proportional growth, they will be more than happy. Sometime you can find a child with a depigmented lesion since birth with white forelock, which is very obviously seen in this patient. Then what is the diagnosis? It is called as piebaldism. What is clinical clue? It is very important. Congenital patterned pigment, almost diamond-shaped vitiligo lesions are there. And not only that, it will be with the white forelocks. And in some part of it, there will be pigmented skin inside. Then comes sometime you get hypopigmented patches with decrease or loss of sensation. In India, any hypopigmented patch other than face, you have to test the sensation. Face, it's very difficult to test the sensation. So I'd suggest the other part being examined for any lesions or peripheral nerve thickening. So if you find hypopigmented patch with decrease or loss of sensation, well, you are dealing with leprosy. Leprosy in children, it is an indicator of disease prevalence in the general population. If you find more number of childhood leprosy, that means it is very much prevalent. And most common type, of course, we classify as borderline, tuberculite, all those things. Nothing to worry about that. Leprosy in children, 57% of the cases occurred from the household contact with their father having leprosomatous leprosy. That means if you find a child with leprosy, it becomes your duty to examine or ask them to go to dermatologist. Whole family has to be examined for the leprosy. This is the treatment regimen. Standard WHO treatment is there. Any leprosy center in it will help you actually. And then sometime, of course, if you see the picture on the left side, it almost looks like, again, hypopigmented patches all over the body. Well, sensation, you may test, and if you persist, they may tell, okay, it's lesser. And then you will diagnose as a leprosy. Unfortunately, it is not so. If you just do some manipulation like what I have done in the right side, you can see individual follicular, that means dot-dot like thing, which has made up a patch of this kind. This is nothing but follicular dermatitis or eczema, which is simply a part of atopic dermatitis, and a sufficient amount of liberal use of emollients would definitely make it corrected. And then the other one is vitreous versicolor, which is very commonly seen, hypopigmented patches in young adults, especially aged between 8 to 12 years. Face is the most common site. And then the clinical clue is a very fine scales will be there. If you just manipulate it, you get the fine scales. That is vitreous versicolor as a superficial fungal infection. The organisms are lipophilic, and so they will be only over the superficial layer. And treatment is just use the ketoconazole shampoo, or oral ketoconazole or itraconazole can also be used. Sometimes child would be brought with streaks of hypopigmentation like checkerboard, in a different fashion, digital like thing. Then it is called as pigmentary mosaicism. Actually, there will be streaks or phyllite pattern of hypo or hyperpigmented lesions along the lines of Blasco. And this is also called as hypomelanosa feto. Why it is important is they can be associated with seizures, and in about 50% of the patient, the other system will also be involved. So hence, when you find pigmentary lesions like these, hyperpigmented streaks of pigmentation, what we call as pigmentary mosaicism, please look into the other system, especially the seizures. And then we can get the linear lesions with small papules along the one part of the body. They are called as lichen striatus. And if you give emollients and topical multisteroid, they will go. And now coming to sometime what happens is you are asked to come to, in fact, I was asked to see a child with multiple hypopigmented lesions like this. The presentation of the admission to the PICU was seizures actually. All these lesions were actually part of tuberous sclerosis. They are called as S leaf macules, and you look like leaf, but inside also there will be some pigmentation compared to the complete depigmented vitiligo lesions. And when I examined the child with such thing, in fact, I would also examine the parents. So this child's parent had the adenoma sebaceum over the face, which is obviously a tuberous sclerosis in the child. And then what happens is earliest signs of tuberous sclerosis is the hyperpigmented macules. Hence, you should be very careful if the child presents with seizures especially, and they do not change the age. And the lack of characteristic milky white appearance of vitiligo lesions, but with also normal pigmented macules within the S-leaf spots, which I have already showed you. Sometimes they, if you examine, if you are more clinically oriented, you want to have a better clinical acumen, well, you have to look into the mouth, especially oral, and then the gingival fibroma will be there. If you see the nail, you can see the Conan tumors along the nail also. Almost the other cutaneous manifestations of the tuberous sclerosis. The take-home message as far as these hypopigmented lesions are concerned, when they present you, most common five, which I told you, most of them are benign condition, need assurance and mild topical corticosteroids, and you have to give a specific treatment in case of tinea versicolor and Hansen disease, and they can be early indicator of the disease like tuberous sclerosis, and if you find pigmentary mosaicism, seizure, and other part of the, say, other systems can also be involved. Then there are certain clues for infections in children. The commonest one would be, again, impetigo, very classically seen as the most important clinical clue would be golden honey-colored crusts are characteristic, which are seen in all these pictures. The another clue is be usually occur at the site of staph colonization, such as nose, or existing dermatoses, such as atopic dermatitis, which are colonized by the staphylococci. This is the honey-colored crust is a characteristic of impetigo. Then you have to differentiate between another impetigo that is called as bullous impetigo and its extension called as staphylococcal scalded skin syndrome. Bullous impetigo is at the mild end of the spectrum of blistering skin. In this picture, a newborn baby with almost exfoliation of the skin, denudation of the skin, almost like a burn is a staphylococcal scalded skin syndrome. How do you differentiate? What is the clinical pearls? Well, bullous impetigo, the exfoliative toxins are restricted to the area of infection. Bacteria can be cultured from the blister content. Whereas the SSS, you cannot culture the bullous material, they will be sterile simply because it is the toxin which is causing the disease rather than the organism itself. And then we have to come to other bacterial infection called as ecthyma. This has to be differentiated from ecthyma gangrenosum, simply because ecthyma gangrenosum is a pseudomonas infection with lot of implications like systemic involvement would be there. So how do you differentiate? Very simple. Ecthyma, the bacterial one, which is usually caused by staph or streptococci, you find a pigmented crust. And what if you press that, underneath there will be pus which oozes. And if you remove it, you get a punched out erosion. Whereas ecthyma gangrenosum, which is due to Pseudomonas bacteremia, clinical clue is it is caused by hemorrhagic papules that progress to bulla and ulceration with dark adherent eschar. It is a necrotic tissue which is adherent. So that is the difference between ecthyma and ecthyma gangrenosum, simply because the treatment also varies, which you know it. The therapeutic pearls for bacterial infections, topical therapy should constitute either fusidic acid or as a first-line treatment or mupirocin. I use often mupirocin. And first-line systemic therapy is oral or intravenous fluoxacillin. And ecthyma gangrenosum, you know the anti-pseudomonal beta-lactams, cephalosporins, fluoroquinolones, and carbapenems can also be used. And another clinical therapeutic clue as far as the bacterial infections of the skin are concerned, nasal swab from the patient and immediate relatives should be performed to identify asymptomatic nasal carriers of staph aureus. I had an experience of seeing a new outbreak of staphylococcal scalded skin syndrome in newborns. That was because the healthcare professional had the carrier states. So this carrier state has to be treated with intranasal application of topical mupirocin for 5 days in a month for 3 consecutive months if you want to remove that, take out the carrier state, especially if there are recurrent infections. And then the other infection which all of you know is the herpes simplex. The clinical clue is the group procycle over an erythematous base. And if it is neonatal herpes, it is a medical emergency. And invariably, it is caused by HSV-1 or 2. The primary episode is associated with constant symptoms, but recurrent will be very least effective, symptomatic actually. The herpes zoster, another one where you get the group procycle on an erythematous base in a dermatomal distribution. Here, the maxillary division is involved, extremely painful, and you can always use cyclovir or the other molecules. And then comes the other viral infection, which is very much commonly seen, especially in children. Self-limiting epidermal viral infection caused by pox virus spreads by autoinoculation. How do you recognize it? Very simple. Skin color. If you see very carefully, there will be central umbilication, pearl-like papule with umbilication is characteristic of molluscum contagium. And it is by needle enucleation you can take it out. Or even topical 10% KOH preparation can be used to destroy the lesions. Of late, some people use even the oral ranitidine. I haven't tried, but I am happy with what I have told now here. And then comes the viral warts, which are a HPV infection. Clinical clue is what you get is hypercoated papules and plaques, and the varicose surface will be there. And invariably, they will be asymptomatic. And treatment is by destruction, either electrocautery or immunotherapy, if multiple. You can use the topical BCG application to them, or sometimes some people use MMR vaccine injected to one, and the distant the lesions will also disappear. And if they're really multiple, what we use is oral retinoids and even the zinc for about 4 to 6 weeks, and they give results. Then another condition which often seen by a pediatric dermatologist is the atopic dermatitis. What is that? It's a chronic or chronically relapsing inflammatory dermatitis manifesting usually in the infancy and childhood and improves with the age. Clinical manifestation occurs in 3 phases. And number one is infantile phase, lasts for about 2 years. Skin lesions mostly covers both the cheeks as it is in the scene in this picture. The lesions will be oozy, itchy, and acute eczema, or scalar ecchi in subacute. That means variation. If it is more oozy, it is called as acute, and subacute, we get only scaling and itching. And all of you know about the atopic march, which is a natural history of atopic manifestation characterized by typical sequence of progression of clinical signs of atopic disease, with some signs becoming more prominent while others subside. And what is important clinical clue is clinical signs of atopic dermatitis predate the development of asthma and allergic rhinitis, suggesting that AD or the atopic dermatitis is an entry point for subsequent allergic diseases. These are the criteria what we use in the Hanifin-Reichke criteria for diagnosis, and the major three or more basic features and good number of 23 almost minor criteria are there. How do you manage? Well, it all depends on the disease severity and baseline. Like, there has to be a regular emollient. You have to use soap substitute, avoid exacerbating factor. You can use topical steroid. And if there is a little more severe, then you have to use the increased potential of the topical steroid. You can use sedating antihistamine at night. And you have to use antibiotic if you find any infection, especially staphylococcal infection. And still more, well, you can always replace with calcium urine inhibitors, especially if you want to have a steroid-free topical therapy. And then still more severe, well, we use the systemic immunomodulators like methotrexate or cyclosporine if it is very much severe. And of late, we, of course, in India, still not available. Dupilumab is the biological agent which is used in severe atopic dermatitis also. And as far as the therapeutic pearl, as far as a topical corticosteroid is concerned, it should not be abused, though it is safe treatment option. Strength and mode of application depend upon the severity, site to be treated, age of the patient. And therapeutic clue is, if you use morning time emollient immediately after bath, evening you can use topical corticosteroid, as BD application of topical corticosteroid is enough, and increase the potential for a short period if there is an unresponsive atopic dermatitis. This is about topical corticosteroid. Once after 4 or 6 weeks, if the desired effect is not there, probably you have to change it to the steroid sparing agents. And how do you use it? Fingertip unit measurement is very important. One fingertip is almost like a 1 gram, 5 gram of the cream, and two fingertip units is 1 gram, and it is sufficient for two areas of the palms area is which can be covered with that much treatment. Otherwise, some people come after applying one full cream and then comes only one day me khatam ho gaya. This has to be addressed simply because the if there is a more absorption, then even the hypothalamic pituitary axis can also be obstructed. And then this is a picture where I used a topical steroid after about 4 weeks, and then followed by topical calcium inhibitor, which has given the desired result. And then come to the other common conditions called as papulosquamous disease in children.
Yes. We have 3 more minutes, sir.
Okay, no problem. I'll finish after this because you had not told me the time. I was adding some more things. Well, this okay. I'll finish. Like pityriasis rosea is very common, begins with herald patch, and then there will be Christmas tree distribution of the Salmon pack, pink papules of the trunk and proximal distribution. What is more important, how do you diagnose? Neck to knee only will be the lesion. So that is one thing. Pruritus occurs more frequently. Natural course is that of spontaneous resolution within 6 to 8 weeks. Then comes the fungal infection. Nowadays, you must be seeing a lot of them. And clinical clue is a round lesion with an active border, classical ringworm pattern. And you have to use the topical luliconazole or other various antifungal agent. If it is more area is involved, then you have to use guaifenesin or ketoconazole, or you can use even the itraconazole also. And then the last one before I really wind up, then you can. Come to the other commonest condition is the psoriasis actually. This is the chronic block type, the guttate type. So this is all over the body. It's very common in children actually. Then the flexural psoriasis, where it is almost mixed like a diaper dermatitis. You find the well-defined glazed red patches in flexures. Concave surfaces are also involved. You have to differentiate between the diaper dermatitis, where the concave surface is spare, and in candidiasis, you get the satellite lesions. And even in contact irritant dermatitis, there can be directly bleb, especially direct application of any irritants there. And then how to manage mild one, it is always topical steroid, topical calcineurin inhibitor, calcipotriene and tazarotene, the topical ones. And if it is more severe, it is better to refer to a pediatric dermatologist, where they use methotrexate, cyclosporine, retinoids, or even the light therapy. Lichen planus is another one. Of course, they are described as purple colored, plain polygonal papules, which are seen around the elbow or neck, knee, and all over the body also. This is acute generalized, where I used the methotrexate. With this, I will conclude. Though I had made different conditions also, thanks for hearing, and thank you very much the team, Kolhapur Pediatric Association, for giving me an opportunity to say. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Inamdar sir, for this useful and very informative presentation. Dr. Ventesh, do you have few time for a couple of questions?
Yes, sir. We have a couple of questions we can ask. Yeah.
Sir, I have one question. As far as these hypopigmented patches are concerned, usually the moment parents see the hypopigmented patch, two questions come to their mind. One is it a treatable condition, which you have already elaborated? And second, will it be transmitted to next generation? So your comments on that.
Well, vitiligo is not it's not a disease which get transmitted. The chance is as usual with any other population. So that has to be discouraged actually.
Okay. The second question is regarding bacterial skin infections. Your experience about the first generation cephalosporins, cefalexin and cefadroxil. So
actually, I'm more comfortable with this. Actually, cloxacillin is the best. Unfortunately, we don't have in market the cloxacillin because of will be with some other drug. I use cephalosporin plus cloxacillin combination usually.
Okay.
I would have loved to have only cloxacillin actually.
Okay. The last question is, as far as scabies in younger infants is concerned, the presentation is varied. Usually, we get lesions on face and also on scalp. So how do you manage? Any tips about management?
Well, what happens, what I observed, not with with due respect to all the pediatricians, you treat only the child. It has to be treated like a mother has to be treated. Not only mother, I usually ask who all take care. Grandmother will be there when the child is little in infantile stage. Mm-hmm. Older one, it's fine. Whole family, whether they like it or not, you ask how many number of people are there, 5, 6, 100, 20, whatever may be number, they must be insisted that they should apply. That is number one. What you are seeing is the persistent lesions over the genitalia. Sometimes papular nodular lesions will be there. That is called as nodular scabies. The persistent reaction to the scabies might will be there. So there you can use either topical steroid, mometasone for about only 5 gram you have to prescribe and ask them to apply for 10 days. Invariably, they do not do it. They keep on applying and then come with the steroid abuse. Instead, though cost is more, that will be a hindering point for them. Pimecrolimus, it costs 300, 400 rupees, but it works very well. And that will also desist them for unnecessary using the molecule and abuse will be stopped. So you can use topical, after the standard treatment of whatever you give, scabies, especially permethrin, what is there available with you, you can use it. Oral ivermectin, I don't think it will act so fast. Only the contacts I can give. Some people who recently, they don't, we don't have this, why should we apply that cream? If it is a small nuclear family, 4 or 5, definitely they apply. Some people come into, in our house, 20 people are there, they live in some farmhouse and all those things. Then the ivermectin, I give them not to miss at least. That is how you can manage. And another thing is, you ask them to apply and within 1 week, they come, no sir, itching has not gone. 2 weeks you have to wait. only after 2 weeks, then think of reinfection, or compliance is not there, or somebody has not applied in their family. So because of the hypersensitivity causes itching to be there for about minimum 2 weeks. That's why you can supplement antihistamine for 2 weeks.
Thank you, sir. Over to Ventesh.